To continue with neurologic imaging, in this short lecture, let's talk about intracranial mass, mass effect, and brain herniation. So when you approach a HCT, rather than going into detailed neuroanatomy, I think a reasonable approach is to focus on several key levels. This is especially important for acute HCT. The four levels that I'd like you to focus on from inferior to superior is foramen magnum, brainstem, basal ganglia, and lateral ventricle. When you inspect each axial view, make sure to compare side to side. Symmetry is important. What's on the left should look like what's on the right. Make sure you look all around. When you look all around, make sure you inspect all the sulci that they are patent, they are not being compressed. Look at all the CSF spaces such as cistern and the ventricles. When you look all around, make sure you inspect gray-white matter differentiation, make sure they are preserved. Let's start with a level, the lowest level at the foramen magnum. At this level, you should be able to see centrally a soft tissue density spinal cord, which is surrounded by relatively hypodense CSF. If you see foramen magnum filled with soft tissue density, in an acute setting, you are probably seeing acute tonsillar herniation. One level above, at the level of brainstem, specifically here is at the level of midbrain. On the axial view, midbrain looks like a Mickey Mouse, and the ear of the Mickey Mouse is cruciate cerebri or cerebral peduncle. Anterior to the Mickey Mouse, you will see a very important star-shaped cistern, supercellular cistern. You want to make sure that it is widely patent. Posterior to the Mickey Mouse, you should be able to see a smile-shaped quadrigeminal cistern and ambient cistern. The quadrigeminal plate cistern is the flat portion. The corner of the smile is ambient cistern. Again, you want to make sure that they are open, not being compressed. The fourth ventricle. To the side, the medial portion of the temporal lobe, you should be able to see small temporal horn. Recall, temporal horn is the most dependent portion of the lateral ventricle. So you want to make sure that they are symmetric and they are not dilated. One level above at the basal ganglia, again, you should be able to see the smiley quadrigeminal and ambient cistern. The lateral ventricles are small and are relatively symmetric. Through the foramen row, you will see third ventricle. Here on the axial view, third ventricle look like a small straight line, and it should be right in the midline. Basal ganglia such as caudate head, lenticular nuclei, medially you have globus pallidus, laterally you have putamen and thalamus, separated by internal capsule. One level above, at the level of lateral ventricle, the lateral ventricles should be symmetric in size. If you draw a line down the middle at the free attachment point of Fox cerebri, the lateral ventricle should stay at the midline. You should be able to see caudate nucleus very well. So those are the key levels that I'd like you to focus on every single HCT. When a sagittal view is provided, make sure you inspect at the level of foramen magnum. If you draw a line from the under edge of the foramen magnum, the cerebellar tonsils should be positioned above the foramen magnum. Also, you should be able to see a nice small cerebral aqueduct. That's a passage point between third ventricle into fourth ventricle. And the fourth ventricle should look like a small, nice triangle on the sagittal view. So what do you look for in terms of intracranial mass effect? One of the major clues that there is potentially a large intracranial mass effect is sulcal effacement. Another strong clue is shifting of the midline structure. Then let's go over some of the major brain herniation patterns that we all need to recognize. In this example, if you look at the left hemisphere, you can see multiple sulci that are widely patent. Those spaces are filled with CSF, so they should be relatively hypodense just like CSF within the ventricle. Compare that to the right side. You will see that on the right, the soft sides are effaced, they are not well seen. So when you see that, you should suspect there's a diffuse mass effect from the right side. In this case, you can also see the right outer ventricle is more compressed compared to the left side. Another major clue is shifting of the midline structure. In this case, if you draw a line down the middle, you can see that at the level of septum pellucidum, indicated by the yellow arrow, there is a shifting of the septum pellucidum from right to left, indicating a mass effect from the right side. So when you see one or both findings, you should have high index suspicion for a diffuse large intracranial mass effect. In this case, the culprit is a hyperdense or acute subdural hematoma. Let's look at some of the major brain herniation patterns. In this cartoon, you see that there is a large epidural hematoma generating a large left-sided intracranial mass. There are multiple different patterns of brain herniation. I like to focus on three major patterns that I think everybody should be able to recognize. One is subfalcing herniation, so brain structures herniating across underneath the falx. Another one is uncoil herniation or transtentorial herniation. In this case, you have a ipsilateral left-sided uncoil herniation. So the uncus, which is the medial part of the temporal lobe, is herniated medially and under the tentorium. If the mass effect is diffuse, involving both sides, bilateral cerebral hemispheres, you can have bilateral uncoil herniation, also referred to central herniation. Lastly, if you have a mass effect within posterior fossa, you can push cerebellar tonsil below the level of foramen magnum, causing crowding at the cranial cervical junction, tonsil herniation. So let's look at an example of subfalcing herniation. In this example, three key images. I'd like you to focus on the middle image and the image to your right. At the level of basal ganglia, if you draw a line down the middle, you can see that the septum pellucidum has been shifted from left to right. When you see that, you should have high index suspicion that there is some large mass effect from the left side. In this case, there is an isodense subdural hematoma. This type of subdural hematoma is the most difficult to detect in that they are isodense to the brain parenchyma. So in other words, there's very little contrast between the pathology itself and the brain parenchyma. So if you don't notice that mass effect, you can potentially miss this very significant pathology. At the level of lateral ventricle, you can see at the free attachment point of falx, there is a left to right subfalcing herniation. So what are the complications for subfalcing herniation? One, you can obstruct the CSF outlet at the level of foramen Monroe. Recall foramen Monroe is the passage between lateral ventricle and the third ventricle. If you have a large subfalcing herniation, as in this case, a large left to right midline shift, usually you will see there's obstruction at the foramen Monroe, causing contralateral dilatation of the lateral ventricle and ipsilateral compression of the left lateral ventricle. Another potential complication is ACA infarction. When you look at this diagram, notice the relationship between falx cerebri and the adjacent ACA. So if there is a large subfalcing herniation, you can imagine there's a potential that ACA can be compressed. This is an example of a MRI T2-weighted image. You have a ACA that's outlined by the yellow arrow, is that black dot and a curved line. They should be in the midline normally. Because of the left to right midline shift, there's a shifting of the ACA to the right, potentially causing compression of ACA. Here's an example of a patient with a right-to-left subfalcian herniation with a resultant right-sided ACA territory infarction. Let's look at an example of a transtentorial or onco herniation. This is the same patient we just see with a left-to-right midline shift. Sometimes the onco herniation can be very, very subtle, as in this case, so your index of suspicion should be high. At the level of brainstem or the midbrain, recall you should be able to see a nice star-shaped cistern, suprasalar cistern. That should be widely patent. In this case, you can see the left ungus, the medial portion of the temporal lobe, is just slightly more medialized compared to the right side. So here you have a subtle or early onco herniation. Sometimes the finding is not subtle. This is another patient with acute trauma. You can see there's a large right-sided temporal hemorrhagic contusion. On day zero, the suprasalar cistern and the smile-shaped quadriterminal cistern and ambient cistern remains patent. So at this point, you do not have an onco herniation. 2 days later, you can see there are multiple hemorrhagic contusions since development, including the left side. Look at the level of suprasalar cistern. You can see the ungus bilaterally are much more medialized compared to day zero. And you can also see the star-shaped cistern, suprasalar cistern, is much more compressed. The quadriterminal cistern and the ambient cistern are also not well seen. They are also much more compressed compared to day zero. So at day two, you have central herniation or bilateral onco herniation. So what are the potential complications for transtentorial herniation? For one of the early symptoms may be third nerve palsy. If you look at the diagram, notice between the ungus and the third nerve. So in this case, if you have medialization or onco herniation, there's a potential that you can compress on the third nerve. Another thing that you may see is weakness. It can be contralateral or sometimes ipsilateral. In this cartoon with a large left-sided epidural hematoma and left onco herniation, the onco herniation can cause compression on the midbrain, causes compression on the ipsilateral corticospinal tract, therefore causing a contralateral weakness. Just like the phenomenon with stroke. If you have a left side stroke, causes right side weakness. It's the same idea. Once in a while, you can have a mass effect that is very significant, causing shifting of the midbrain from left to right. And the midbrain can impinge on the right side of tentorium, cause a physical notch. That's a Kernighan's notch phenomenon. In this case, you can have compression of the contralateral corticospinal tract, therefore causes ipsilateral weakness. So the weakness can be contralateral or ipsilateral. Another potential complication is PCA infarction. In this diagram, you can appreciate the relationship between ungus and the adjacent PCA. So if you have an onco herniation, there's a chance that you can have a mass effect against the PCA, causes a PCA infarction. This is an example of somebody with a right-sided onco herniation, causes right-sided PCA infarction. Lastly, let's talk about tonsillar herniation. In this case, at the level of midbrain, you can see that there is bilateral cerebellar tonsillar herniation causing effacement of the suprasalar cistern, the star-shaped cistern, and the quadriterminal plate cistern. So there is central herniation. That mass effect also translates into a large mass effect within posterior fossa. So at the level of foramen magnum, you can see that entire foramen magnum is filled with soft tissue density. Compare that to a normal patient. You can see in a normal case, at the level of foramen magnum, there is hypodense CSF surrounding the upper spinal cord. In our patient, the entire foramen magnum is filled with a soft tissue density consistent with tonsillar herniation. When you suspect tonsillar herniation, you should ask for a sagittal reconstruction. For a normal patient, again, the cerebellar tonsils should be positioned above the foramen magnum. In our patient, you can see the tonsil is herniated below the level of foramen magnum, and there's diffuse crowding at the cranial cervical junction. CSF has no place to go. This is another case with a large posterior fossa lesion in a pediatric patient. There is a mass effect, causes a tonsil herniation and crowding at the cranial cervical junction, causes obstruction of the lateral ventricle and the fourth ventricle, so obstructive hydrocephalus. Also in acute setting, if you have acute compression of the brainstem, you can cause respiratory or cardiac failure. Those are some of the potential complications for the major brain herniation patterns, things that we all need to recognize on head CT. If you have any questions and comments, please email me at the following address. Thank you so much for your attention.